In 1870, Jacob A. Riis came to the United States as an immigrant from the small country of Denmark. He landed a journalistic job working with New York's police force. Their beat was the Lower East Side. Riis was immediately stricken by the desolation and depravity he witnessed while traversing amongst New York's tenement housing. Riis used the agency of journalism and a newly developed form of flash photography to publicize the plight of the poor. There were many New Yorkers at that time who had no idea of the lamentations that lurked just around the corner. Using a culmination of his human interest pieces, Riis wrote the book How the Other Half Lives, and the chapter within it entitled The Downtown Back Alley. This chapter describes, in narrative form, the exigence comprised of greedy landowners and landlords, the dreadful state of the tenements, and the declining health and welfare of tenement residents. Riis writes, "These tenements never had any other design than to shelter, at as little outlay as possible, the greatest crowds out of which rent could be wrung. Dirt and desolation reign in the wide hallway, and danger lurks on the stairs. A sanitary officer counted 146 cases of sickness in the court, including all kinds of infectious diseases. There were 9 in the family. All 9 lived in 2 rooms. The rent was 7.5 a month, more than 2 weeks' wages. The father was the only breadwinner. The mother had thrown herself out the window and was carried up from the street dead." These words are not so much steeped in argument as they are a discourse of social and economical issues and a call to see the importance of these issues. Kenneth Burke states that rhetoric is creating realities in which we must operate. Riis creates for his audience a bleak reality. Reckless selfishness and a system that is the evil offspring of public neglect. The act, the exigence, is too obvious and awful to ignore any longer. Riis engulfed his 19th century audience in a type of virtual reality, and as his secondary audience, we are submerged as well. Suppose we look into a tenement. Here, where the hall turns into utter darkness, is a step, and another, and another. Riis utilizes appeals to the body as he takes his audience, both in the past and present day, on a guided tour of the tenements. He asks his audience to look into the dark alleys, feel their way up a flight of rickety stairs, listen to the soft cries of a dying baby, and smell the poisoned air. In summary, Riis's rhetoric reveals a plea concerning the universal logos and pathos of human dignity and a transformation towards a progressive movement that sought out innovative ways to better the lives of those less fortunate. As a further result of his rhetorical renderings, tenements were eventually torn down and sustainable living places and parks were put up in their place. For his ethical work of recording factual flaws in the established norms, Riis was named by President Roosevelt America's most useful citizen. His hometown of Ribe, that once saw him as a lowly carpenter, now hails him as a hero, and the citizens of New York are ever grateful for his tenacity in challenging the system.